All right, lastly, to wrap things up, let's briefly talk about the practical aspects of this course, the tools that we are going to use. As you have already guessed, probably, we are going to use Python as our main programming language. So here's a nice chart by Jake Venaplas, who made it in 2015. It is outlining the different layers of the Python ecosystem, the scientific computing ecosystem. So you have Python at the lowest level, that's the basic fundamental thing that all these libraries require. And then layer by layer, these libraries become more specialized. So you have general computing libraries like the IPython interactive computing environment, the NumPy linear algebra library. There's Cython, which kind of helps inputting or using C code in Python if you need it. So that's something we won't be doing in this class, but for certain scientific projects it's also useful to make things faster. There's Jupyter, that is ecosystem providing Jupyter notebooks, which you have probably heard about already. I will say a few things about Jupyter later. So let me not say it here, I will say it later. So then there are other libraries like SciPy, which are providing additional algorithms on top of NumPy, or the visualization library like Matplotlib, and Pandas, which is a data frame library. I don't want to go over the other ones because we won't be using them in this course. So the only maybe notable ones are here, or is scikit-learn, which is a machine learning library that we have used in statistics 451 in fall semester. And there's also ML-Extend, which is a library that I developed implementing algorithms that are not implemented in scikit-learn. So I called it ML-Extend for machine learning extensions because I was not very creative. So these are libraries that we used in 451. And we won't be using those at all in this class. So there's basically almost zero overlap between these two classes. And that's not really an advantage of taking 451, because really we will be focusing on deep learning here and not on traditional machine learning. So in this class, we will be mainly using Python and PyTorch. PyTorch is a library built on top of Python. We will, of course, also be using a little bit of NumPy for some basic computing, especially in the next lecture, to just introduce things slowly. And then, in the third lecture on perceptrons. And then also we will be using Matplotlib occasionally to make visualizations. But the focus will be really on PyTorch. Regarding Jupyter, so honestly, I like Jupyter notebooks a lot. I have been using them a lot for data analysis. However, based on my experience, I actually recently started to prefer using regular Python scripts when working with deep learning. There are many reasons, because deep learning code can be very verbose sometimes, and sometimes it also takes a long time to run, and sometimes I also run that on different computers via the terminal and things like that. And there are just certain aspects where script files are a little bit more convenient to handle. Also, one aspect is that there are easier ways to debug your code, because there are nicer linters and code highlighters in text editors or IDEs, developer IDEs. So I will also say a few words about that maybe later. So regarding PyTorch, why are we going to use PyTorch? So personally, my history is like I started doing deep learning or working with neural networks in like 2013-14. There was a library called Theano that I've been using extensively. And for my first machine learning book, I was also using that for the neural network chapter. Then in 2015, a new library called TensorFlow was released by Google, and I started using TensorFlow like everyone else back in 2015. I really liked it. So I've been using that quite a bit in the last couple of years. But then in 2017, So this was 2015. 2017, PyTorch came out, which made certain things way more convenient. So personally, I felt the library was a little bit more organized. It had dynamic graphs. It was a little bit closer to NumPy. Nowadays, I mean, both PyTorch and TensorFlow have very similar features. Both have static and dynamic graph support and so forth. So there is not that much difference anymore. But in the years between, I would say, 2017, 18, 19, PyTorch was much, much nicer than TensorFlow, like from my personal view. Also, the deep learning community really like PyTorch, because you can see based here on this visualization, this is like the top machine deep learning and machine learning conferences. You can see that there is a huge growth in PyTorch use. So the solid lines here are PyTorch, the graphs for PyTorch from 2017 to 2019, middle of 2019. So the 2020 conference year is not included because this article is from 2019. Unfortunately, they didn't update this article. But yeah, you can see there's like a steep growth for all the conferences in terms of PyTorch use, whereas for TensorFlow, it's rather going more like downward, or yeah, not growing as fast. So that way, many people have adopted PyTorch recently. And also when you look at papers, so if you find a new paper and you look for code on GitHub, you will most often find nowadays that there is PyTorch code. Of course, there's also often TensorFlow code, but yeah, PyTorch is or has grown a lot, so it's also very popular. Why is it important that a library is popular? So yeah, one reason is really that if you want to implement more sophisticated models, it's yeah really easier to find tutorials or example code or the implementation corresponding to a paper and so forth. And for this class, really, I still find PyTorch is a little bit more organized and easier to use than TensorFlow. It's more similar to NumPy, and I think yeah you will appreciate that because yeah, the learning curve is not quite as steep. So yeah, just for fun here, I made a short, I implemented the Leonard 5 that we talked about, a short code implementation. Like I said, I kind of, for deep learning nowadays, prefer using text editors. The reason really is that, for example, if I make a typo here or something like that, it will underline it, and there are way more convenience features. And deep learning code can be sometimes long, and I find it easier to develop code in a text editor nowadays. I still use Jupyter notebooks a lot. I'm just currently even today I've been working with them extensively, working on a paper where we made visualizations. And for things like that, for analyzing data, it's really, I think, really great to use Jupyter notebooks. It's just like if you write long code, like more like coding the networks, I find text editors more convenient. Personally, I would recommend, for example, a text editor like Visual Studio Code, which is fast, free, and works on all operating systems like Windows, Linux, and macOS. Personally, I use a Mac, but this is supported by, it's supporting all major operating systems, and it has great support for Python and also debugging and things like that. So yeah, anyways, here, this is just a brief outline of how the Leonard looked like. So if I hit enter, yeah, so this is the one doing the image recognition here, the handwritten digit recognition. And you can see in PyTorch, it's actually just a few lines of code implementing this rather complicated convolutional network. So you can see there are lots of things going on, but in PyTorch, it's just a few lines of code to implement this model. Of course, there are a few more lines of code to train the model, but actually it's not that complicated. And we will walk through this in more detail step by step later in this course. So for right now, you don't have to understand how this works. I just wanted to show you the code is actually not that complicated. So here I was just running the code also. I was running it on a computer that had a GPU. So in this case, I was running it for 10 epochs, which means 10 iterations over the training set. And the training set, I think it has 60,000 images. So you can think of it as 10 times 60,000 images, training it on that, and it only takes less than a minute. So it's super fast, and even then after a minute you get already almost like 99% accuracy. So here just some visualizations, and you can see even like after the second or fourth epoch, it already reaches something like almost 99% accuracy, which I think is really impressive. So this is on the validation set, sorry. So you can see actually there's a gap between validation and training set, which indicates overfitting, but we will also talk more about that later. It's just like a quick demo of how deep learning works and looks like. Okay, so let me finish this introduction. So if there are still some things that are unclear, I mean, this was just an introduction. So just an overview. I noticed that I went into too much detail here and there. So if there are some details you don't understand yet, don't worry about it too much. I've actually written a blog post on this because I was planning to write a little textbook based on my lecture slides, which is an ongoing project. I'm not sure when and if I ever finish this. But anyways, I uploaded the first chapter here as a blog post, so you can actually read everything I talked about in written form. And also, for those who are just interested in a general overview of traditional machine learning, you can find the lecture notes for the 451 class. So just if you're interested, you don't have to read this, of course. However, what's also maybe helpful is chapter one of my Python machine learning book, which is, I would say, a shorter version of this blog post. It's of course written differently. It's a little bit, I would say, smaller and shorter, and not quite the same. It's just like a different perspective, because that's something I've written quite some time ago. Okay, so with that, let me wrap up this introduction, and in the next lecture we will be looking at the brief history of neural networks and deep learning. So I will just mainly outline why things are cool and interesting, and go over the major architectures, because this will give you the big picture overview of the topics we are going to cover then throughout this whole semester.